My name is Nina Khrushcheva. I teach international affairs here at the New School. And this is the last event of our semester-long Hollywood symposium, which was dedicated to the 25th anniversary of the Cold War. And the reason we wanted to do it is because, of course, the minute you either go online or open a newspaper, if you still open newspapers, or listen to Charlie Rose either in on CBS this morning or on the Rose show in the evening, you would know we are in the new Cold War. So we want to investigate what's the reason for that, not political so much, but cultural as well. So what is that remaining animosity between the former superpowers, the US and the Soviet Union, now Russia, and how it plays out. I want to just sort of remind everybody that this is a live stream, and I want to thank the live stream audience, which I hope is larger than this audience, and hopefully people would step in. I want to thank Gabrielle Belli, who was incredibly instrumental in putting this together, and also others who helped. I also obviously very much want to thank Todd Gitlin and Eliot Borenstein, who came here. Todd came all the way from uptown, from Columbia, and Eliot didn't have to travel that far. He just crossed the park and came in from NYU. You do have our bios, so I'm not going to spend time introducing the speakers, but here they are in the front row. So we will speak for 15 minutes each, or maybe a little longer, and then open it up for questions, and then try to conclude by 7:30 this evening. I will start, if I may, just because I have visuals and presentations and kind of go quickly through various points that I want to make. I will start bashing Hollywood, and then I will give podium to other speakers, and I may end up with bashing Russia or not, depending on what Eliot has to say. So I will amend my presentation in this. So I'm not going to go through this. I just put it up so we would know what we're talking about, what the Cold War was, and also what the new Cold War is. I actually call it the frozen peace, because in my experience, repeating old brands is not always a very good idea. Although I don't know how peaceful the frozen peace today is, but certainly with annexation of Crimea in 2014, with Putin's involvement, or Russia's involvement, I must say, although they're all denying it, in East Ukraine, the involvement in Syria, clearly this is what we're facing today. And one of the important political points is that the actions behind, thinking behind Putin's actions or Russia's actions is that Russia no longer is willing to observe the post-Cold War world order and doesn't want war and peace to be dictated just by the United States and Western partners, but say the United States. What really made me interested in the subject is that, as a Russian, you may guess that I am, I was always very traumatized that even though Russia stopped being an enemy in 1991, the First Cold War was over, we were still actually very much portrayed as enemies, and for a long time I couldn't quite understand why. So in some ways I was thinking that Hollywood may be villain in this kind of relationship. Because even before Putin took Crimea, already 60% of the Americans regarded Russia as a very bad guy on the world stage. So this is my, look at the 1990s. Boris Yeltsin, the first Russian president, was very amicable towards the United States, and here hits 1997. And all these mafia movies or communist mafia movies come out. I think Air Force One was probably the most famous. And at the time, I remember I was looking at the screen and thinking, oh my God, what did we do to you? What did we really do to you in 97? Why are we so why are we so guilty? Are we still your enemy, and why are we? So Cold War, just a reminder, there are many examples of Cold War movies, and in fact, during the symposium, we did talk about a very brief period of love affair between the United States and the Soviet Union in the 1940s, early 40s, during World War II. Because the Soviet Union was American ally, and so there was a mission to Moscow, which is a masterpiece of propaganda and bad movie making, and some other films that we were watching. But here is sort of the brief snippet from the 50s, the 60s, the day after the Rocky. So this is, as you may remember, 85 was already the end. Beginning of the end of the Cold War. Mikhail Gorbachev comes to power, and of course there's all bonds. In fact, my colleagues here, we spoke about Bond, and I just for the pleasure of viewing put the naked Daniel Craig and the naked Vladimir Putin, because these are the people very often paired up, Putin by the Russians, and is seen as a James Bond of contemporary Russia, and of course by the rest he's the Bond arch-villain, the anti-James Bond. But here you go, the glasses, the all the necessary attributes. I have a brief clip from Dr. Strangelove, because I think Dr. Strangelove is really important for our conversation, and the reason it is important is because it was one of the best spoofs of when the Cold War, or when the animosity really was brought to the final point of idiocy, and just going to show very. So here you go, the big board, the planting pictures, the camera, all these familiar themes that we are still experiencing today, but there was clearly a very, very incredible satire. And it is interesting that after the Kubrick masterpiece, there was still very little irony about the films that were made even in later years. And so I come back to the 2000s, which is probably my favorite period, because Vladimir Putin was still a good guy. I mean, they were, as you remember, George Bush looked into his eyes and saw his soul, and Vladimir Putin was a great ally in the war on terror, and all these incredible, incredible things were happening in the relationship, and yet, we already couldn't do any wrong. Please forgive me, I'm really a sucker for commercials. I think they represent sort of the thinking of, is it this one?
You're in my head.
Which one is it?
It's in the toolbar.
I minimized it, okay. Here you go.
If you do your best thinking in the shower, imagine how smart you'll get under the new shower heads at Holiday Inn Express.
Checkmate again. Gentlemen, the invisible airplane.
What a load of...
Okay. So, 2004, no Soviet Union, and yet it just hits you because you know exactly who the enemy is, how the enemy is. It's under the red flag. It's a very... A very grumpy, very big man who is playing chess. So you don't even need to think. That's what you know and how you know it. One of another favorite examples of mine is the Golden Compass. I'm not going to show just for saving time. It's a kids movie based on a British series. A really very good one. And there, the enemy, as we know it, because the Rasputin-looking angry warriors shouting scary Russian. And unless you know Russian, you actually don't know that this is in Russian, but it is in Russian. Once again, it just hits you right here. You don't need to have any information. You don't have to have any knowledge. But the enemy, as you know it. I think Eliot is going to talk about this more, but at the time when all this was coming out in the 2000s, I kept thinking, are we really, is Russia really such an ultimate villain? I mean, yes, Putin wasn't the great guy. Even after George Bush looked into his soul, there were dishonest oligarchs that he was punishing. He was clamping on irresponsible press. But really, was he that kind of villain? And what I came up with is that precisely because the enemy hits you right here and you don't need to know much, we all need an enemy to define ourselves. So Cuba was too small and Castro is too old. North Korea's Kims are all the same. They're a good enemy, but you know, Putin is infinitely more entertaining because he's more diverse. China is a trading partner and the Arabs are politically incorrect. So I thought that if I don't know if you're going to talk more about it, but this is a very brief summary of why Russians really present a very compelling enemy. In fact, in 2007, around the Golden Compass and other films, Putin defied the Cold War and he became a man of the year in the Time magazine in 2007, and he declared that there would be no Cold War anymore and really not something that he would pursue, and they, in fact, were better enemies than he was, such as Gaddafi in Libya or Ahmadinejad in Iran. But nonetheless, all this continued, and Putin basically, you know how they say Hollywood made him do it? I almost feel that that's the case. So then I moved to 2010s. That is when Russia was officially a bad guy. In 2012, Putin decided to come back as the Russian president again after 4 years. He just is the prime minister, but we already in 2010 with Angelina Jolie starring in Salt, we already knew that, you know, Russia is basically finished as a possibly positive entity. So there I put together a couple of things that were really interesting. One of the interesting things was the Americans. As you remember, 12 spies landed or got caught in 2010. In fact, I must proudly say that one of them was my student here at the New School. Yes, exciting. His name was Richard de Murphy. That's how he pronounced his name, and I totally knew he was Russian, but hey, he's Richard Murphy. Interesting, tonight after this panel, I invite you to go and watch The Americans, because they're going to be the retelling of The Day After, which was a very important 1983 nuclear apocalypse drama. Nuclear story, even if it seems it's over, it's actually not, because Russia today Putin started talking about nuclear attacks more than ever before, saying, well, the countries that have nuclear weapons should not be judged by the same standards, because we may be able to use them. So it's interesting how the Americans are going to investigate this. Tonight. So then there are a couple of other things. I mean, those of you who watch cartoons with your children or grandchildren, I remember I was stunned in 2010, Despicable Me. Steve Carell suddenly was featuring a Russian accent, which was entirely unclear as to why. And yet he did. And so there's a lot of many other kind of collections of interesting developments. I know Todd is going to talk about the Bridge of Spies, so I'm going to refrain from my analysis or explanation of this. And you sort of to summarize it further, in 2012, remember when Mitt Romney said that Russia is the number one geopolitical foe and everybody laughed at him, and in fact, the Russians laughed at him more than anybody, saying, well, he watches too many Hollywood films. Well, guess what? Maybe he didn't watch that too many Hollywood films, but Putin surely did, because as of 2014, as I mentioned earlier, he just very comfortably slid into this bad guy shoes that Hollywood already pretty much predicted for him. Now I want to finish with this. So then after the panelists speak, I may or may not go back and sort of talk about not only how Hollywood made him do it, but how Putin himself made it do it. And it is very interesting as a phenomenon, because I always say to my students that culture never lies about politics. Things that we think are completely not credible yet, we already, if we watch very carefully, we already have the information and can almost decide the information that is available to us and see it then politically playing out. Okay, well, thank you for this. And now I want to invite you back. And thank you. And I guess maybe we can start with Eliot, because then we're going to
America.
Russia or America, yeah, and then Todd will deal with America.
Okay. Okay, great. Well, thank you, Nina. For me, the context behind all of this is about how, even as we talk about the old Cold War and the new Cold War, the conflict and the emotional investment was completely asymmetrical. I'm not talking about warheads or anything like that, but on the one hand, you have in the Soviet Union a real constant fascination with America, not as the enemy, but as something kind of sexy and exciting. And in the United States, for the most part, except for as an enemy, no, people weren't thinking about the Soviet Union nearly as much, and people don't think about Russia nearly as much. In fact, one of the things that is so poignant about the discourse in the Russian media and the American media is that you get the sense that in Russia, people think we're thinking about Russia all the time, and they really hope it's true, even if it's bad, that we're paying attention. And we usually only pay attention when it's bad. On the other hand, the Cold War itself was asymmetrical, culturally asymmetrical in a completely different way. And I know this from talking to people who try to do Cold War courses, Russia-American Cold War courses, and they're saying, where can I find a good Russian Cold War film? And then find it with subtitles. And you know, you think about it, you find things, but it's not nearly as obvious as it is on the American side. So in America, for a long time, we were producing a great deal of cultural material about the Cold War and about the Soviet threat. Even if sometimes it was about needing to become friends with the Soviet threat, like the representation of the Klingons on the original Star Trek. They're clearly supposed to be Russian stand-ins. Then when they become our friends, they become Japanese stand-ins, but that's a whole other story. What's happening is that the funny thing is, you would think, based on what you'd know, say, of Stalinism and spy mania at that time, that you would expect to see a great deal of attention to the American threat in the Soviet Union. But actually, there's nothing comparable to what's happening in American culture. And I think one of the explanations is that it's just not necessary. In the American political conditions, ironically, since we usually think of mobilization as something the Soviet Union did, American culture really did need to mobilize people, mobilize the population to think about the Soviet threat to justify a great deal of expenditures and decisions and so forth, justifications that the Soviet leadership really didn't have to make. For one thing, there's not as much expectation of, say, grassroots opinion reaching the top. And also, if you think about the conflict simply in terms of defending yourself against an enemy, thanks to the experience of World War II, convincing the Soviet people that they need to have a strong defense is a no-brainer. It almost doesn't matter who the enemy is. The experience was so traumatic that, of course, you need to defend yourselves. So in fact, at the time when in Hollywood we see all of these Russian and pseudo-Russian enemies, you know, Boris and Natasha from Bullwinkle, or actually from Pottsylvania, but come on. At the time when we see all this in Hollywood, there's almost none of this in the Soviet Union. There's very little demonization of Americans as Americans. Why do Soviets and then Russians and in America, we never understood the distinction anyway. Why did Soviets and Russians become such good enemies in our mass culture, and why did they stay that way? And Nina alluded to it, and I want to develop this a bit more. Part of it, of course, is that Hollywood is terrible at nuance. I think we know this. And when it comes to coming up with a bad guy, coming up with an enemy, there are all sorts of immediate cultural restrictions that come up. That, you know, even clueless people in Hollywood know that whether or not they're racist, they don't want to be perceived as racist. So in fact, it took a long time for people to notice that actually their stereotypes about Arabs were really insulting, for instance. But what you needed was an enemy that wasn't racially coded. And I think of a stand-up routine by a comedian named Dan Soder, who refers to Russians as the scariest white people. And that in this case, what you have is an enemy you can identify who isn't particularly racially coded in any way, and who isn't associated with a large population living in America who can be offended. So it's almost, they're the perfect enemy because they're almost not real to most people in America. So, and they stay that way. By the time you get to the 90s and later, when people are actually more sensitive to questions of race and politics, it gets even harder to come up with a good enemy. So the Russians, why not? You know, who cares? I think that whereas in Russia at times this is portrayed as Russophobia, as this intense hatred of Russia, I think in fact it's more like for Hollywood, you may as well be talking about the Klingons. There's actually a phenomenon now on the internet in Russia in which a certain subset of people, of Russian nationalist fantasy and science fiction fans, go on and on about how The Lord of the Rings is actually about fighting Russia / the Soviet Union. The orcs are the Soviets, and the orcs are Russians. So they proudly claim, yes, we are orcs. There's this whole orc movement. It's a kind of ironic, sarcastic orc movement. And I think they're right, they're not right about Tolkien. They're absolutely wrong about Tolkien. But they're right about Russians in Hollywood, because Russians in Hollywood may as well be orcs, for the most part. In Russia, what was going on in Russia, they certainly needed enemies, of course, but Russia, the Soviet Union had a much more problematic relationship with portraying evil and portraying conflict and portraying enemies and portraying violence. So the big villain in Soviet popular culture for decades was the Nazis. Now they're safe, everybody hates the Nazis, and some of the Germans are on the wrong side of the Cold War, and World War II becomes the formative story for everybody in the Soviet Union once it is over. So it's replayed again and again. While we're fighting the Russians, they're still fighting the Nazis, and they are still fighting the Nazis. Now granted, we love to bring back the Nazis in American popular culture too, because again, you know, who's going to be offended on behalf of Nazis? Some people, but they're not going to admit it, or we're not going to care. But again, in the past 20 years, there's been a real resurgence of fiction in which the enemy is the Fourth Reich, and Hitler is frozen on ice, and so on and so forth. So the Nazis are a kind of dependable standby, and they're more problematic for America because, of course, you know, World War II does not mean as much for us, and there's the question of German allies. And then two, when it comes to this question of the enemy, the Russian perceptions of what we're doing with Russians in Hollywood are different from what we might expect here, again, in part because of differences of conceptions of race and ethnicity. In Russia, race was usually not the question people were talking about. It was a problem that other people had, in particular the United States. The fault lines were what was called nationality or ethnicity. And once you talk about people in terms of ethnicity or nationality, then Russians are up for grabs, because Russians are a nationality, Russians are an ethnicity. So particularly now, when you have pundits in Russia talking about the terrible portrayal of Russians in Hollywood, it is portrayed as a kind of ethnic, Russophobic attack. I mean, some of that is a complete misunderstanding of how this works in America. I remember reading I read lots of trashy post-Soviet novels, and in one, a post-Soviet action hero who is also a spy has a friend and colleague who's in the FBI and is of Russian descent. And there's a mention that his family had really difficult times during the McCarthy era because of their Russian last name, which totally gets the McCarthy era wrong, but reads it in a perfectly Russian fashion to understand ethnicity in this particular way. Okay, so the Americans were not bad guys for quite a while. And there was this great deal of love for America and admiration for America. And I've talked before about actually how really in the relationship between Russia and America, it's this unrequited love affair, and America is the ultimate bad boyfriend. You know, we don't call, you know, we break up by text. It's this horrible thing, right? We don't pay enough attention unless we act really, really bad. then maybe we can get their attention. And so the Americans become the enemy slowly, in part by the end of the 1990s, people are really sick of being lectured at by Americans and by American proxies, of being told that this is how you should have your economy, this is what your political system should look like, and nothing you do is right. So there's a lot of room for resentment there. But then also, things change, of course, under Putin and Medvedev for a variety of reasons. I mean, the whole conservative value nationalist thing of Putin's and his regime is a relatively new one, but what you do have for the past several years, when it comes to America, is actually a wonderfully horrible American record in foreign policy, if I'm going to make some sort of generalization about an audience here at the New School, I'm going to assume that people are probably more left than not. And pardon me for the stereotyping, but let's face it. So a lot of us in this room could say, yes, George W. Bush's foreign policy was bad, a disaster. We shouldn't have gone into Iraq. Yeah, we shouldn't have done this. We shouldn't have done that. Within the United States, we tend to think of these things as something associated with a party, a leadership, a person, and not what our country is doing. But abroad, in general, and in Russia in particular, this is just what America is doing. So what people critical of America and Russia can point to is, you know, America is always going around getting into other people's business and leaving things worse than they were when they started, which is actually a hard point to argue against. Score one, right? And then two, Americans are always preaching about how you're supposed to have a democracy and about how things are going to be better under democracy, and yet, most of the time when we go in there and try to set up a democracy, once again, we leave things worse than when they started, and arguably something similar could be said about what was going on in Russia. So this, in fact, poisons us as not only as messengers of democracy, but even poisons the idea of the democracy and quote unquote freedom that we are spreading. So we end up in the popular culture, now that we're enemies again, and we're big enemies in fiction. I'll get to reason why it's mostly fiction. You have stories about Russia invading America to get back. There's lots of stories about Russia invading America. It's so much fun. And there's one in which they capture an American soldier, and they're trying to interrogate him. And whenever they ask him questions, he answers things like, "I am from the freest country in the world. My country is the freest country. We are so free. You are not free." So what happens then is this whole discourse of freedom becomes the way in which we're brainwashed and trying to brainwash everybody else into wanting freedom, which is actually a poor standard of living and total mismanagement. For the past 20 years, there's been a whole range of conspiracy theories, older than 20 years, but especially in the past 20 years, conspiracy theories about how certain people are trying to destroy Russia. Now, who are those certain people? Well, Jews, of course, always, but also Americans, or the same thing, depending on whom you're asking there. And so there's this idea called the Dulles Plan, associated with Alan Dulles, though he never came up with it. It comes from a crappy novel in which America is trying to destroy the Soviet Union by ruining its values. This is still with us in Russia today. It still comes up as fact. The Harvard Project, where people in Harvard are trying to ruin Russia by injecting them with stuff that's going to change the DNA and turn everybody into debauched homosexuals. Sounds also kind of current in its way over there. But a lot of these things were thoroughly on the fringe. And you could find them. I certainly found them. But I felt kind of guilty talking about them because I felt like someone coming to America and discussing America by reading a lot of Lyndon LaRouche. But now in the age of Trump, I could feel differently about that. And in fact, all of this stuff has gone from the margins to much closer to the mainstream. So you hear this not so much in film and television. It takes longer, it's more expensive, and so on and so forth. But on television news and documentaries, and so-called documentaries, on talk shows, again and again you hear the story of how America destroyed the Soviet Union and is trying to destroy Russia. Ironically, if you think about how the Republicans, after the end of the Cold War, took credit for the collapse of the Soviet Union, well, think how that looks from the other side. yes, America did destroy the Soviet Union. They were against us, and they're still against us, and they want to destroy us now. So we've done a great deal to help. We, you know, they, the people we didn't elect or no one elected, have done a great deal to help create this image of the enemy. But where in America, the Russian enemy, I think, is to a large extent a kind of lazy habit. Because they are the scariest white people. In Russia, it's an innovation to have us as the enemy. So we can congratulate ourselves on a new variation of our importance to Russian popular culture.
Thank you. So before I talk about Bridge of Spies, I want to say something about Hollywood's quandary after the Cold War. Because I feel, if such a thing is possible, I feel almost pity for Hollywood, because there's an enemy crisis. And I think they've reacted in a scattershot way. I think that it's been a challenge to try to strike a note, an orchestrating note or a chord that can resonate not just in this movie or that television series, but across the board, so that there would be a kind of cultural clarity, a kind of lining up of iron filings in which the enemy would be sharply enough delineated and consistent enough to form a kind of cultural organizing principle. I think that Hollywood has floundered in the absence of that organizing principle. Now, there is no shortage of enemies, and some have already been alluded to. Before I get back to Hollywood, let me just say it's obvious from certain political campaigns that Mexicans will serve as a certain kind of enemy. Certainly all kinds of Muslims, especially Arabs, will serve as enemies. Occasionally Russia will, Chinese will step in, the North Koreans and others. But I think that actually the lack of a powerhouse enemy, a clear and present enemy of the sort that the Soviet Union organized, the way the Soviet Union organized American culture for so many decades, has actually spilled over into a proliferation of surrogate enemies, surrogate menaces. I'm thinking about sort of futurist monstrosities. I'm thinking about the Mad Max sort of futurist apocalypse scenario. And I'm also thinking of zombies. I don't purport to really understand the zombie thing, but it's not to me as straight ahead as the body snatchers image. Many other films of the 50s, which presented the menace of the sort of the all around, the all purpose brainwash menace. Sometimes it was the Chinese, as in Manchurian Candidate, but mostly it was the Russians were the incarnation of that uniformity, that standardization, that conformity that was in fact a cultural norm, but it was convenient to have an enemy on whom to project that fear. And now we don't have anything so clear, so we get this sort of diffuse image of omnipresent dead people, which to me is not so much a successful substitute as a kind of hand waving, a kind of throwing up of the hands as if to say, we're scrambling as fast as we can to organize the culture for you, but we really don't have it. And in that sense, the diffusion of the enemy is sort of matches the diffusion of media. That is, just as media are not so organized anymore, so it is that the central, if that it's difficult to summon a central cultural principle, much more difficult than it used to be. So I'm struck by how in your list of the films of the 80s and more recently, I don't think I've seen half of them or even heard of a lot of them. And it's not because I don't go to the movies or watch television. It's because there's just so much. You know, every Friday, the New York Times is reviewing 15 new films that are opening over the weekend. And that's not counting what shows up on television and so on. So that's the background to what I'm saying is that I think that we do not have this cultural organizing principle, which is in many ways beneficial, but it's a serious change from the Cold War regularity. Now I want to turn to the particular film that I thought was actually revealing in a different way of the difficulty, of revealing in an interesting way. And there's nobody, I think, who's better to talk about as a sort of condensation symbol, a sort of master orchestrator of such cultural regularity as we have, as Steven Spielberg. So the fact that he wanted to make this film was itself a cultural statement. So I'm interested in exploring what he actually did with it. Now, this was not the first time that big players in Hollywood were interested in the story of James Donovan and the prisoner exchange. According to Donovan's daughter, Donovan is Tom Hanks. According to Donovan's daughter, whose name is Mary Ellen Donovan Fuller, it was Gregory Peck, right after he won the Oscar for To Kill a Mockingbird, who wanted to play the role of her father after he published his memoir, which is called Strangers on a Bridge, about the 1962 spy exchange. And Peter Ustinov, who was then a fairly big player was a Brit, but a Hollywood-connected Brit, set to work on a screenplay. And Alec Guinness, no less than Alec Guinness, coveted the role of the Soviet spy Rudolf Abel. This was, we're now talking about years before John le Carré had given him another kind of Cold War role to play. Donovan had defended Abel in court. Abel was indeed a Soviet spy living in Brooklyn under cover of being a photographer. He was smuggling stuff out. And Donovan had defended him in court. This is the axis of the story and the movie. Donovan's defended him in court and earned the opprobrium of many patriotic, fervent Americans who didn't think that a Soviet spy deserved a fair trial. Donovan, by all accounts, was actually a remarkable figure. He was a far-sighted man and practical at the same time, which was not so easy to find in freaked-out early 60s duck and cover America. In court, and this line appears in the film, Donovan said, it is possible that during the defense of, in arguing against the death penalty for Donovan, I should say, for Abel, in arguing against the death penalty for Abel, Donovan said the following, it is possible that in the foreseeable future, an American of equivalent rank will be captured by Soviet Russia or an ally. At such time, an exchange of prisoners through diplomatic channels could be considered to be in the best national interests of the United States, which was quite a prophetic feat. And he prevailed. Abel was sentenced to 30 years in prison. So Donovan not only anticipated such a deal, I'll talk about the art of the deal, but 3 years later, he negotiated it. He arranged to swap Abel for the spy pilot, Francis Gary Powers, who was shot down in the super secret U-2 spy plane while overflying the Soviet Union in 1960. This act generated much chaos and consternation in Washington. The official American line was that the U-2 was a weather plane that had wandered into Soviet airspace after taking off from Turkey. And then when your ancestor, Nikita, produce the pilot alive, who would decline to kill himself with his CIA-supplied poison. President Eisenhower was humiliated. So enter Donovan to do the deal, and that's the bulk of the work of the film. Then comes, now 50 some odd years after the failure of the first attempt to make a film about this, I think, extremely cinematic story. Doesn't need much elaboration, doesn't need much much tinsel. Along comes Steven Spielberg, who is probably our official narrator of National Legends, and pairs up with Tom Hanks, who is our most reliable hero now that Gregory Peck has sadly left us. One critic writing about this film put it beautifully, I think she said, this is Barbara Vancari of the Pittsburgh Post-Gazette, said, no one does decency like Tom Hanks. So, alas, it's only in an alternate universe that we can imagine what Gregory Peck, Peter Ustinov, and Alec Guinness might have produced. But Hanks can pull off a line like, will we stand our course less absolutely than Abel stands by his? And coming from Tom Hanks, it sounds authentic, to use a word. So Spielberg is our master of decent longings. His myths of America are I think, our most convincing in recent years. And when I say myth maker, I don't mean falsifier, because Spielberg elevates rough factuality to the level of the legendary. He's so accomplished with everything from his casting to the bombastic music and so on, not despite the fact that he trades in stereotypes, but because of it. This is what he's good at. And my view of Bridge of Spies is that the stereotypes of which Bridge of Spies is composed have the virtue of combating the contemporaneous, that is, the early 60s stereotypes of Cold War lunacy. After all, in the film, the FBI are flat-footed morons. The CIA are cynical. Now, the rest of the stereotypes are your standard issue 50s stereotypes. The all rise for the judge when the judge enters the courtroom segues into a shot of young, of children standing up to recite the Pledge of Allegiance. The curmudgeonly judge has a soft heart. All the 50s cars are gleaming and two-toned, as if the ambience of the film shouts out, this is what it meant to when America was great. This is what it looked like. No dents, no Volkswagens. And in Donovan, he has a compelling hero, because Hank's version with fedoras, suspenders, and so on, is an avatar of fair play. He's not the ugly American. He's the fair-minded American. He is, in a way, the equivalent at the time of those lawyers who today, against the howling of the mob, defend prisoners in Guantanamo. And meanwhile, in Rudolf Abel himself, Spielberg also has not only a superb best supporting actor, but actually a rather sympathetic figure. He's a professional doing his job. He's not, he doesn't have fangs. He doesn't foam with demented commie language. These are honorable men. The two of them are paired, the good Russian and the good American. They don't panic their way into a Manichaean worldview. They're not the kind of people who think, you know, it's us or them. It's the good guys against the evildoers. There are plenty of evildoers to go around. So Putin, to jump to actuality, Putin and our own homegrown conservatives, some of whom call themselves progressives, but that's another story, are quite excited about beating their bare chests to Cold War rhythms. And the Cold War itself, 1945 to 91, would seem to have expired unmourned and unremembered, not least for the so-called millennials who were born after it ended, and I think have trouble getting what that Cold War was. But what interests me is that when Spielberg found a way into the Cold War, which he had not previously found, he found a way to tell it in his own sort of melodramatic freshness, in which America's obsessions are in a way turned sideways, and what we're left with is anxiety. There is a happy ending, but it's not America triumphant. It is James Donovan triumphant. Donovan, by the way, no small historical rhyme here that doesn't come up except in a crawl, in a title shot at the very end. Donovan, just after the Able defense, in both senses, was commissioned by President Kennedy to negotiate the return of the CIA-inspired and recruited prisoners in Cuba, which he did quite successfully. He had actually an excellent future in politics, so died sadly young. So back to the general frame of this, I think that we should appreciate Spielberg's the Spielberg finger on the pulse, and the pulse does not beat to the thrill of the Cold War. Nobody will ever make "I Married a Communist" or oh no, that's sorry, that's Philip Roth's story. I led three lives. Whatever the other one was. The candidate whose name I shall not speak has trouble summoning up a super enemy. You notice it's striking to me, you know, he's going on about Mexicans, and then he's going on about everybody's ripping us off and we're losers and so on. And the first name that trips off his tongue when he's talking about who's out there to get us, Japan. It's like, it's back to 1991 when Sony purchased Columbia Pictures and Newsweek had a cover story, Japan invades Hollywood. So he's still there. It's confusing to know how the world is organized, and I think we have it. We can thank Steven Spielberg for failing to take the easy way out.
So a couple of things that I actually wanted to comment on, if I may, first to Eliot, and then to talk about, actually we don't disagree with Spielberg, I just thought it was boring and a little pretentious.
Oh, of course,
Spielberg and Tom Hanks.
Exactly, with Tom Hanks. I mean, I know he pimps out decency and he does it really very well, but it is indeed sort of that cynicism where once again we go back. He's just a decent duty Harry, because America, even if America fails as a group, it still wins as an individual.
It's clean Harry.
It's clean Harry, yeah. Exactly, thank you. That's even better, it's going to be clean Harry. So what I wanted to say to Eliot, I totally agree with the whiteness, and you say that for the Russians, America is really not that interested. I agree. I had, in the midst of the Ukrainian conflict, I, for once out of, in 10 years, I taught a class on Russian politics. I had 7 students in the class, and I asked them what they're interested in. They're really interested in Putin. They're not interested in understanding all these other things, because Russia is the past, in some ways, Russia is the past enemy. It's the Hollywoodishness of Putin that is so interesting. But I just want to defend my people, and I have to say that when my people, they may misunderstand this, mm-hmm. but let me tell you, when America as a country, they watch the November Man and the Americans and the X-Men. Maybe you don't guys mean it, but it looks very real.
Yeah.
That Hollywood is out to get us, and so we have to produce something back. So I think that sort of, it's almost like when Barack Obama had this conversation with Dmitry Medvedev about the what was the shield? What was the name of it? The new
Captain America?
No. The new Star Wars thing that George Bush instigated, when you put the shield against Iran in the countries that closest to the Russia, whatever the name. There was a name of it,
name for it.
Something shield. Yeah. And Barack Obama said to Dmitry Medvedev, well, you know, it's just wait for me to get out of the election season and we'll address that. It doesn't really work for the other countries. When you have a shield and it's against Iran, but it's in the Czech Republic, Russia does take this thing seriously. So I just want to say that even if it may look ridiculous from here, it doesn't look ridiculous. Mm-hmm. Doesn't look ridiculous from there. So I just want to kind of end up with this. So when Putin is watching this, he feels bad. He says in 2006, he says, we build ties with Western partners. And then in 2007, he already says, this is a new colonialism. In 2012, he gets elected and says that his opponents are not going to defeat him because it's all against the Russian statehood. And by 2015, which is more post-Crimea, post-Ukraine, here he is with the Night Wolves, which is his bad gang, which is weird because can you imagine a president that is part of the gang? But Hells Angels and Bandidos, they're initiated in the United States, and so it's very easy to brand them as the agents of imperialism, which they very successfully do. And mm-hmm. So just to kind of follow up on Eliot's point, Russia does produce all these shows and movies. So for example, in 2014, an interesting one came out, it was called Tragedy Chernobyl. Yes. You remember Chernobyl, yeah. The 30th anniversary? So to Eliot's point, so CIA blew up Chernobyl nuclear plant in Ukraine in 86 to discredit the Soviets, and I quote, put Soviet economy and politics on its knees. So here you go, no conspiracy theories. Where the motherland begins, an immigrant who was misunderstood in the West comes back to Russia and struggles to regain the motherland and whatnot. So it's all really kind of comes in parallel terms. And a lot of these things, as Eliot very correctly pointed out, is that once for 15 years the post-Cold War really didn't work out as we didn't become partners, then we are going to really go on and become enemies. And so one of the things that the biker gang leader, Putin's friend, he's a huge fan of Mad Max. In fact, he models himself on Mad Max, which always goes in contradiction because all this foreign movies are now being slowly banned, not banned, but kind of scaled down because we have our own greatness, as you could see. And yet, a lot of it, the invasion of the body snatchers, incarnate in the new era. So it is a very interesting symbiotic relations. Maybe for Russia, America is a newer enemy, but even as a newer enemy, it was an easy one because, so my last point, in 1936, the movie came out called The Circus, where you have an evil German and a woman who had a black child, American woman who had a black child, who found happiness in the Soviet Union because we have no race. or no racial issues. So in some ways, as different as it is, it really comes back to its original kind of rail tracks all the time. Okay, so any comments to each other? No? All right. Thank you so much. And now, if we have questions for us, and we hope you do.
This is a question for everyone. Do you think that the media...
If you have questions, we're just going to wait so you can...
Bring up to the mic over here so
So do you think that the myth of the frontier is anyhow related to that American choice to go for the Russians in terms of the enemy? I mean, especially if you take into consideration Kennedy and the new frontier.
The myth of the frontier. I wouldn't think that they're directly related. I mean, there are wonderful ways in which Russia and America kind of rhyme with each other when it comes to the frontier and the expansion. But I wouldn't see that as really at the heart of what's going on now, unless you make it incredibly metaphorical about presence on the world stage. So for instance, I've heard people refer to, you know, Russia's involvement in Syria as if we didn't have an involvement. So there's a sense that what there is a sense of being accustomed to the idea that America goes around and meddles and that Russia shouldn't. But I'm not sure if that's really a frontier thing.
Well, I think we were just, I think in some ways what we were talking about, so you have, it's not even the Russia-America Cold War, but The Martian, for example, is a frontier mm-hmm. movie. Mm-hmm. The American Cowboy, The American Sniper, sorry, is a frontier movie to some degree. So that kind of one American that goes and helps, and even if he's tortured, like Tom Hanks, mm-hmm. he's still a good American. Right? Mm-hmm. Does it make sense?
Yes.
And with space, oh, sorry, go ahead. No. With space as the frontier, actually, if you can go back to Armageddon, not the event, but the movie, at one point in '99, I think it was, we had two different Meteor Strikes the Earth movies, and this was the worst of the two. There's a moment with the space station, with the International Space Station, and the Russian Parliament, members of the Russian Parliament were outraged by the way that the cosmonaut was portrayed there, but on the other hand, he was, the stereotype there was he's out there in the frontier with very few things, but he's really able to cobble together lots of things from the crap that's left over. So turning this particular Russian myth of having crap but being inventive with it into something that you could be proud of even if the Duma wasn't.
This is by way of a free association to your question. When I think about the frontier, of course, it's one of the classic American stereotypes. Richard Slotkin's written about this going back into the 17th century, you know, the barbaric Indians. So the frontier is a place of barbarism, and we certainly saw versions of that in the Cold War films of the United States. But it occurs to me by contrast, I didn't make this point before about Bridge of Spies, that even the sort of the higher level Russian who's at work here, the embassy official, is actually extremely civilized and decent. I mean, he's not a barbarian. He's actually a civilized person. So he's there with Abel and Donovan as the way decency ought to be conducted, and very different from the old imagery.
Oh, and I'd also want to add that linguistically, at least, if not quite historically accurately, one of Russia's great frontiers is Ukraine.
Yes,
so, and you can connect those dots fairly well.
No, this is actually a really very good point, because in some ways I think there's similarities between in the Cold War, but even in the Russian-American relations in the 19th century, because in some ways they're both countries, they're imitation, because they both take Europe as the center of it, and frontier, because Russia is, or at least saw itself in the 19th century, and a little bit in the 20th, but more so during the Russian Empire, the original Russian Empire, as this block of land that keeps the West from being attacked by the uncivilized Asia.
Which makes me wonder what if any movies the Russians are making about China?
It doesn't provide enough of a soundbite. I mean, and they're really, if you could see, because all of this is World War II or some wars that we didn't have with China. So it's Afghanistan.
There was a war with, I mean, a sort of unofficial war with China.
Right, but it was unofficial and it was long, and it's not, it doesn't really create the public, the public myth.
And it was mostly secret, wasn't it?
It was secret, and it doesn't create, I mean, it's like the war with Finland. It just doesn't create a public myth.
Right. And also China, I think for a lot of people in the post-Soviet space, China is the one that did post-socialism right.
Right.
Exactly. You know, they didn't democratize. They liberated the economy to some extent. And who cares about?
Right. They kept their Mao, and we denounced our Stalin.
Right. And look who's doing better now.
Right. Exactly.
Yeah.
Please.
I was going to ask about what lies behind the term Hollywood, because I found interesting the discussion of myths and the content of these movies and the narratives. But I would like, if you could, to talk about what is the process by which these movies get made? Like, who makes the decisions as to we're going to push this idea or we're going to push that idea? Like, has anybody done any research where you can, I don't know, find minutes of meetings or some kind of hard evidence as to what is the actual process by which these cultural products get put out into the market? And, you know, along those lines, maybe you could also comment, is it who owns the cultural industries that's key? Because it's obvious that it's Hollywood is connected to the news media, it's connected to the television industry. These companies are huge. They have a movie side, they have a music side, they have a, you know, they're not just making movies. So if I'd like you to comment on that.
Once upon a time I did research and wrote a book about the television entertainment business. I know how they work. I can't tell you how the movies are made, but I very much doubt it's terribly different. They don't care what's on the screen, as long as somebody can make a case, a plausible case, when they're talking among themselves, that they can capture eyeballs. They could care less. You know, they'll give you Beyoncé, you know, and Black Lives Matters. They'll give you, they'll give you friendly Russians. They'll give you, they'll give you warm-hearted Muslims from time to time, at least as foils for wicked Muslims. It's in its own way a kind of a diffuse system, because you have the studios, but they're not the powerhouses they used to be. You have to talk now about investors, you have to talk about bankers, and what's bankable is Tom Hanks. I mean, if Tom Hanks wanted to play a friendly ISIS guy, I wouldn't put it past him he was misled and so on, and he has a heart of gold. They don't give a shit about politics.
And if I could follow up actually with what Nina said about how, you know, these movies look to Russians, the X-Men thing and all of the other things, they notice it because they're Russians about them. But I think what happens is that your question would be answered probably very differently on Russian television, which would be the State Department. Exactly. The State Department is the source of all evil, by the way. The State Department, which can tell Fox News what to run, by the way, it's wonderful. Obama tells Fox News what to run. The State Department is behind all of it. And if there's anti-Russian stuff up there, the State Department has determined this, and everybody falls in line because that's the only way these things are being imagined.
I mean, the backstory of the day after was that there were executives, one executive in particular at the network, who was in an uproar about the possibility of nuclear war. There was a lot. This was during the Reagan acceleration, Star Wars. And it was actually quite reasonable to be concerned about the actuality of nuclear war. And this executive green-lighted the project. It was hardly designed to flatter the White House, to the contrary. Although, by the way, it may have had actually a good effect on Reagan. mm-hmm. who, by the way, didn't, you know, was not somebody who wanted a nuclear war. Mm-hmm. And it's, you know, it was actually an element in his attempt to give away nuclear weapons at Reykjavik in 1986. It's a whole other story, but
and there are also
quite fascinating.
Yeah, and there are no Russians in the day after.
No,
right,
of course not.
Right,
right, so it's, I mean, it's a very, it's a nuclear war can be, could be framed in a way that's, that it's almost not about the people.
So it could, it could be Martian.
It could be Martian, and really, in a sense, the enemy for anti-nuclear propaganda, if you want to use the term, is us, right? Because we're the ones that have to be convinced, America has to be convinced to disarm. It's not about, even though the Soviets would be the ones bombing us, it's not about the Soviet threat.
So again, you know, around that time, I forget when it was exactly, this film appeared, Red Dawn.
Oh yeah, that was great.
81? 82,
Patrick Swayze.
And talking about Russians invading America or something.
It was great.
It didn't, you know, it was a marginal film. It was not a huge treat. And then another network decided to make America with a K. That was around 90.
It was in response the day after. And I had Chris Christopherson.
It was their response, that's right.
Chris Christopherson, I think, was the K.
And, you know, I mean, again, it was a reasonable calculation about audience potential.
So follow up.
It could have been the other way around either. The same executive could have advocated the one who advocated the other and vice versa. Marketing.
Just to follow up on this, because there have been books written on the Hollywood system and how it was created on the studio system and, you know, the foreignness of those films, but also how all these foreigners would become great Hollywood executives, and a lot of them actually were immigrants from either Germany or Russia. So you may want to, if you're interested in this, you may want to look up those books, because they are interesting and they talk about this. Because it is free, because all these things, I mean, yes, they were created on Russian television, but Putin winks at those. Mm-hmm. So Putin actually says, we're not going to show horrible foreign films. We're going to have our own heroic here, and nobody does that. So it's this incredible symbiosis of what capitalism is. It's the sort of political interest, economic interest, and also cultural interest. Things go boom with us. We're a good enemy. So we assume that people would buy those.
Are there any reliable data on the audiences for these films? Like, how did the Chernobyl series do? The one about the CIA blowing up?
It actually didn't do very well.
I'm happy.
Right. But actually, don't get so excited about it, though. Not necessarily because it was, nor that they didn't buy the fact that CIA destroyed Chernobyl. That was a very good story for mm-hmm. them. It's just people don't want to talk about Chernobyl. Ah. So these are different things.
Yeah.
But for example, the Snow and then Ashes did incredibly well mm-hmm. because it's kind of Dr. Zhivago-ish, but the Russian way of Dr. Zhivago-ish. And it has all the right music. And that's what's so beautiful about the Russians. I mean, Eliot, who knows Russian literature very well, is that how Russian's 19th century literature is basically all the mock-ups of German and French, but we created our own great literature in it. So this is sort of the same. Mm-hmm. This is sort of the same thing.
Hi. So, Todd, before you were talking about how not having such a clear enemy to project our fears on anymore, like we did with the invasion of the body snatchers and all of the sci-fi and everything, and how this diffusion of the enemy is sort of happening. But that makes me think about how Marvel is such a huge phenomenon today. How this is something that Nina and I usually talk about. How we have these superheroes fighting enemies that we make up without this typical way of doing things. And I'm just wondering, especially with Marvel slated to make like 20 movies, you know, I mean, this isn't stopping anytime soon. I'm just wondering what you or what anybody else might think about this Marvel phenomenon in terms of enemy and representation.
Well, I've read every Marvel comic ever made, so.
That's expertise.
Yes, exactly. It's I teach a comics course actually because I had to put that to some use. What I think is really interesting when you compare the superhero phenomenon with action stories in the Soviet and post-Soviet context is how wonderfully they display the different backdrops against which these things are happening, right? So the superhero tradition, I mean, there are lots of ways of defining a superhero, but and any aspect of a superhero definition can be violated by some superhero, but basically superheroes tend not to work for the government, though sometimes they do. They tend to have a mission, though sometimes they don't. They tend to hide their identities, but sometimes they don't, right? So, but on the whole, they are individuals who have been motivated to do something, to step in and act. Vigilantes, in a way, but good vigilantes, or framed to be good vigilantes. Action stories have been hugely popular in the post-Soviet space, but there are some comics now actually being translated that have superheroes, some Russian superheroes, but really the thing that is the functional equivalent of that in post-Soviet popular culture is war stories, military stories, or the heroes either were in the military, are in the military, they're spetsnaz, they're something, and they have guns. They have, in the picture, they have these huge muscles and guns. It's all Rambo. And they are part.
Red stars on their.
Yeah. So they are incorporated into a system more obviously than the superhero is. And some of that, I think, is that in the absence of a superhero tradition, there's little cultural room to imagine someone like this who isn't part of a military background. But that also there's a long tradition of these military stories of being what, you know, the fun stories for boys. But what you end up is this stark. That's a bad pun for Marvel. Stark contrast then between, and nowadays people get this. 20 years ago, no one would have gotten that. Between what we're showing in our movies in terms of the action heroes and what is being created in Russia in terms of action heroes. It's all the World War II model projected onto other scenarios.
So I have a question for everyone, since I'm not paying that much attention to popular culture. Are there movies, TV series, comic books in which the super bad guys are these monstrous rapists from Mexico? I mean, is that because there would be taboo for big cultural production outfits to indulge in that kind of stereotype?
Almost everybody in the comics industry is liberal. So that when Frank, or some version of it, when Frank Miller, the
dark, so here it does matter.
Here it does matter. So, but Frank Miller, the Dark Knight Returns guy, was hugely popular in the 80s and 90s. He kind of went crazy after 9/11. He's not the only one. But he wanted to do a DC comic of Batman fighting Al-Qaeda called Batman Holy Terror. And the cover of it was supposed to be Batman punching Osama bin Laden, just like Captain America punched Hitler. And DC finally just couldn't let him do it, and so he came up with his own analog of it, a Batman-like hero, and published it from some small independent company. There's actually very little room in the comics world for anything Trump-like.
But what about movies? I mean, are there... Are there right-wing movies that about, you know, vicious Mexicans? I mean, their gang lord is a sort
they're
of...
Not, the way they get around it, they don't make them Mexicans, they're drug dealers.
Drug dealers?
You find a lot of things with either drug dealers.
Yes.
And these, there's been a rash. I mean, there's always been this plethora of the police state cop shows.
Yeah.
But then they have this thing now where you have this plethora of military, it used to be JAG, but it's not JAG. This is the police investigative services of the military doing civil work, which, mm-hmm. you know, goes against posse comitatus, but hey. And slickly what's put into that, they use an ex-rap star who supposedly knows how to speak Arabic, and then they weave in a terrorist. And the terrorist is always a black or brown person.
Okay. There's also, to answer your question quickly, there's a Netflix series that came out where Mexicans are drug dealers and killers, and I think it's called Sicario, right? Is it? Mm-hmm. So that it's just very, very recent. It just came out. I don't know if it did so well. It was advertised greatly, and then somehow it died down because maybe they.
I mean,
were
given
too,
the number of people who hate immigrants, I would think there's a market here, so it's sort of interesting.
But I think, yeah.
What has also happened, what is not being said, okay, and And I was a kid, I grew up with Marvel. We used to, you know, to 12 o'clock to, you know, you probably remember we played stickball, and then it got hot around 12 o'clock and in order to cool off, you know, because your mother's not going to give you that money for your ice cream. You sit there with Kool-Aid, and we pass around comic books trying to find, whoever stoop had the shade of the tree, we were passing around these comic books. Right. And they did have a flavor of anti-communism really woven in there. You know, like when Iron Man, it was titanium. So when I was a kid, too, I hit a science class, I thought, well, gee, you know, the Russians didn't have iron. They just had titanium in the ground. And we had, you know, we had steel mills here. That's what happens. Mm-hmm. Shamefully, the new Marvel movies have a slick way of making Nixon the hero, Nixon a good guy, who was a total criminal.
Mm-hmm. Well,
a malfeasant criminal who basically, you know, got to rob the U.S., you know, a criminal put on the pension of taxpayers, mm-hmm. ripping off the government. But what happens in the classroom is, because these children don't know the Cold War and the Cuban Missile Crisis is not in the textbooks, mm-hmm. so they're going to think the X-Men, you know, Magneto just froze the missiles in the midair.
But in the comics, I mean, I think every president should be a hero. Do you have a question?
Yeah, I did, but I'm just saying.
Okay.
Nixon is not a hero.
Because we have other people. We know that.
Really.
Right. We are the news.
Pick any other president other than a few, quite a few slave owners. I mean,
we are at the news school. We know he's not a hero.
I also want to question the fact that you had trouble with the body snatchers and these apocalyptic kind of, you know, disease kind of things, because every government needs an enemy to win a point.
Right.
Reagan at the time hated people with AIDS. So those movies came out with AIDS. If you look at a person who's walking dead, AIDS people were thought of and marketed by the government as walking dead. And then it came back out, you get vampires and all that when the Ebola hits. So you have this, they're watching this nonsense at night, and then they get the misinformation through the news because they work in, you know, in cahoots. So therefore, these are the boogeymen. I think it works more with that. I don't find, you know, the Walking Dead people as, you know, Russians. No. All right. So another thing I have to ask, because I saw a PBS documentary about, it talked about two brothers that were, well, they weren't brothers, they were two Germans who had fathers that were high up in the Nazi regime. One actually paid the price in Nuremberg, the other one hid out and then died. But they took a trip to Ukraine. And sadly, you know, you see this image in Ukraine because it's a thing where they find certain people who are war heroes, but they're in Nazi, there's a division or whatever, however it broke down, whoever fought on the side of the Nazis. But this is in the year 2000, whatever, that this was done. You see people, and they found an old Nazi car. They're riding the coffins up in Nazi regalia. And you have to wonder about the fascism, as I mentioned before, some time ago, that we are supporting. And remember, Dulles snuck out Nazis and brought them here. So
okay, so thank you. We have one more question, so I want
so
to...
So in Hollywood, I got to, you know, I'm looking at certain films, and I understand that, but I mean, I think maybe if we look at it in that way.
Okay, thank you. Anybody wants to take on the...
Well, I would just address...
Zombies and the Nazis?
Absolutely.
Okay.
Zombies. I would alter your timeline a little bit. For AIDS, it was vampires because of the bloodborne contaminants, AIDS. So vampires were the perfect thing in the 1980s. They had this big resurgence. Hmm. I would think that...
And the Charlton Heston film where he was the last man on Earth.
Yeah, well, that was a remake. But then there's... with The Walking Dead, though, I think The Walking Dead and Trump work really, really well together because zombies, the great thing about zombies, so vampires are individuals. Vampires are charismatic and they can individually infect you. It's like AIDS. But zombies are the faceless, unwashed, horrible masses. Zombies are immigrants. Zombies are the poor. Zombies are the third world. Zombies are also people who have been, zombies are also Trump supporters, right? You can turn the zombies into any mass of people whom you find unwashed and horrible and a threat as a huge group.
And AIDS, which happened with Reagan, mm-hmm. he vilified the Haitian nation.
Sure.
which this country has been vilifying since they got their freedom, but he vilified them as they're the ones that brought AIDS here.
Sure, sure.
And when you look at it that way, I guess whatever, most of those things have like a blood transfer situation.
Okay, we have another question, thank you.
Yes, I just wanted to answer your question about movies displaying Mexicans. You had to watch Univision, television. They are two, they're like novellas, but they are like novellas and movies, like very real. La Reina del Sur is like the Queen of the South. Mm-hmm. It's a woman who's a drug kingpin, and El Cartel de los Sapos. And it's like Sapo is somebody who betrays in the drug trade, you know, that's a Sapo. So you don't want to be a Sapo. Yeah. So El Cartel de los Sapos.
The good guys?
They are the good guys, the drug dealers, you know, like, meaning, these are very popular, like, they are followed, but everybody look at these guys, like, these guys are bad, you know, like, because there's a lot of violence, killings, drug dealing, those are, like, two big series that they're still going on, but they were, like, big hits, like, everybody watched them, Univision and Telemundo, those two.
But I think generally in world culture now, the bad guys sort of, as you were talking about the Bridge of Spies, even the bad guys have a soul. As bad as they are, we still want to show how the complexity and fragmentation of it. Thank you very much all. And thank you, panel. It was most interesting and entertaining. And I wish you all a good evening, and watch the Americans because they're going to blow up the world again.